If you have your Bibles, I want you to open to one of our key texts. First Samuel chapter 11. And let us read a little bit. And we'll say something briefly. What I will say briefly can be powerful. So I want you to look at your neighbor and tell them your help is on the way. Tell them again your help is almost here. I love this thing. It's a thing of hope. It is a thing that tells you not to give up. Most especially in the times that we are in. And I tell you the truth, I've been around for some times, but I've never seen a time where the people are having tough times like this time. We've helped people by the grace of God concerning education and so many things. But I haven't seen a time like this where we are overwhelmed with the problems of people. You know, where you are paying 14 persons school fees, and apart from the 14, another 20 coming to ask for help. It has never happened. It never happened before. And when you wake up in the morning, everybody crying with different problems. I've seen people cry, but not at this time. And I believe that is the reason why God gave you this topic. To let the people know that no matter what is happening, your help is on the way. 1 Samuel chapter 11 and verse 1, I promise you I won't be long. The Bible says, then Nahash, the Ammonite, came up and encamped against Jabesh-Gilead. And all the men of Jabesh said unto Nahash, make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee. And Nahash the Ammonite answered them, on this condition will I make a covenant with you, that I may thrust out all of your right eyes. See that kind of a covenant. See the condition of the man is there. That he should pluck out all of the right eye of everyone in the city. So that everybody there will be one eye giant. And lay it for a reproach upon all Israel. So that it can be a disgrace for you. And the elders of Jabesh said unto him, give us 7 days. Give us 7 days respite, that we may send messengers unto all the coasts of Israel, and then if there be no man to save us, we will come out to thee. Then came the messengers to Gibeah of Saul, and told the tidings in the ears of the people. And all the people lifted up their voices and wept. They were hopeless. They brought news to them and they began to weep. And behold, Saul came after the herd out of the field. And Saul said, what aileth the people that they weep. And they told him the tidings of the men of Jabesh. And the Spirit of God came upon Saul when he heard those tidings. And his anger was kindled greatly. And he took a yoke of oxen and hewed them in pieces and sent them throughout all the coast of Israel by the hands of messengers, saying, whosoever cometh not forth after Saul and after Samuel, so shall it be done unto his oxen. And the fear of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out with one consent. And when he had numbered them in Bezek, the children of Israel were 300,000, and the men of Judah 30,000. And they said unto the messengers that came, thus shall ye say unto the men of Jabesh Gilead, tomorrow, somebody say tomorrow. Even though you guys are fainting right now because of the news you heard, you are fainting because of what Nahash has said, but tomorrow. No matter what is happening today, there is a tomorrow. Yes. Is somebody here with me?
Yes.
I said, no matter what is happening today, no matter what your condition is today, as long as there is a tomorrow, help is going to come. Yes. If you believe it, your amen will be louder than that. Tomorrow, by that time, the son be hot, he shall have help. And the messengers came and showed it to the men of Jabesh, and they were glad. I want you to know that this verse number 9 is tied to verse number 6. Verse number 9 is tied to verse number 6. Because verse number 9 said, while they were weeping, the Spirit of God came upon Saul when he heard those tidings. And by the inspiration and the working of the Holy Spirit, through Saul was how they got the news that made them glad. Amen. You see, when we look at verse 1 of this passage, I told you today I want to take my time. The Bible said, Nahash the Ammonite came up. He came up. You know, many times people become hopeless because of two major reasons. Or let me make it three major reasons. People become hopeless because of three major reasons. And what are three major reasons? Number one, they don't know who they are. Number two, they don't know where they are. And number three, they don't know whom they have. Three major reasons why people are hopeless. So many persons today are crying without hope, simply because they don't know who they are. They have identity crisis. They don't know their identity. And so they are crying. People today because they don't even know their position. They don't know where they are. And some people cry without hope because they don't know whom they have. You know, Paul said, "And God be for us. Who can be against us?" That simply means when God is for you, anyone that decides to be against you is irrelevant. It doesn't mean when the Bible says who can be against us, it doesn't mean that nobody will rise up against you. They will rise. But they are irrelevant. What they think they are doesn't really matter to us when we know that we have God. What they think they are depending on, for which they are coming against us, doesn't really matter to us because we have God. Yes. So you can see that people are kind of hopeless because they don't know who they have. And people are hopeless because they don't know where they are. They don't know their position. People are hopeless because they don't know their identity. In the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17, just 6 chapters after that one, you find out that for 40 days and 40 nights, Goliath rose up every day and defied the army of Israel. And the Bible says that every time Goliath stood up and asked a question in the morning, "Hey, I'm here. Who amongst you can challenge me? Come and find me." And just by his speech, they all take cover. Why were they taking cover? Because they had a problem with their identity. Seem so big when you don't know who you are. Every time Goliath showed up, the Bible says when he began to speak, the army of Israel will take cover. How do I know that? On the 40th night, when Goliath showed up for the 80th time, a young boy by the name of David was in the midst of the army. He was in the midst, but he was not enlisted. Sometimes you can think that you are not necessary because you are not enlisted. Sometimes you think like that. You say, "Well, I don't think I'm important because the people that didn't make me part of their group, they didn't make me part of their clique, they didn't make me part of their leadership, they didn't make me part of their club, so I don't think I have anything to offer." He wasn't enlisted, but he was in their midst. And the Bible said when Goliath showed up and began to speak at the 80th time, David was finding a way to see who was speaking like that. And everybody else was pulling David. "David, can't you hear even the voice? Can't you see? Why do you want to show up? Come on!" They were trying to pull him in the corner. But David was not just trying to see him because of the size. But David was trying to find out, who has the audacity? To come and challenge this kind of an army. But the army didn't even know who they were. Yes. So how did David defeat Goliath? David said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine to challenge the armies of the living God? The army did not know their identity. They didn't know who they belonged to. So Goliath tried to divert their attention from whom they belonged to who was part of them. In 1 Samuel chapter 11, verse 11, the Bible says that, and they were all in disarray, and they were greatly afraid. And what Goliath would tell them? He said, who among you saw us and me? He didn't want him to know that it was God. He changed their identity and they accepted it. So one of the reasons why people are hopeless is because of identity crisis. They don't know who they are. When a man leaves you today, you behave like it's the only person you're depending on in life. And so you are going to die. You get frustrated. You get depressed. Until you lose your head. You lose your beauty. While there are 1,000 more men admiring you, you are spoiling your beauty because of one man who is not even qualified for you. The reason why you think he's the best that you can ever have is because you don't know who you are. Do you know that what people can dash most of the time in the market is what they can afford? When you go to the market to buy, or you go to the grocery store, or you go to the shopping mall, when you pick up the shoes, they say, how much? Or you look at the tag on it. What? They're going to shoot $350. I'm going to buy one pair of shoes, $350. They're like, I'm like, you know what I would find? They're like, you know why you're dashing that shoe? Because you can't afford it. Some people are leaving you because they can't afford it. Tap your neighbor so the bishop is talking to me. Some people dash you. And yet you don't know that you are one expensive stock. You know, a guy had a girl, and then after he tried, he was spending some money on her, and he was doing some things for her. And after a point of time, the girl decided to leave the guy. But all of his friends knew that this guy really loved the girl. And truly he loved her. So he was doing everything for her just to keep her around. But yet the girl still left him for somebody else. And the guy called his men together and said, gentlemen, it's my man, why the girl left me? He said, gentlemen, today is a good day for us. He said, man, you should be crying. If I love somebody that leaves me, I will cry. You see, you guys always make mistakes. I love her, and she's leaving me. But I should be happy that somebody who doesn't love me is leaving me. She should be crying that she's leaving somebody she loves. Somebody that loves her. He says a breakthrough for me. You see, when you understand who you are, and I'm writing a book called Discovering Your Spiritual Value. When you understand who you are, people don't mess with you easily. So most of the problems we have for which we are crying, we don't even know what we are crying about. We don't even know what we are crying about. Every little thing you are just crying. All because you don't know your value. You don't know yourself. So imagine Goliath defying those people for 40 days and 40 nights. And the only thing David can say, well, who has the audacity? Who has the guts to challenge this kind of army? Not know the army, they even know themselves. So when David realized that whole army couldn't stand one Goliath, David said, well, I can take him on. Only one thing David used, just knowing who he was. You see the man from circumcised, I'm circumcised. That's identity. Circumcision, you have a covenant with God. This man doesn't have God, I have my God. So if you go further in 1 Samuel chapter 17, the Bible says, and Goliath cursed David by his cause. So everything Goliath was doing is that he was depending on something that was just around his waist. Somebody having rope around his waist be able to defy me who in the palm of my God. So David said, well, since that what you depending on, I can be switch your battle. He said, you come against me with all your things, but I come against you now in the name of the Lord of hosts. Let it be God to God. My God will give your head to me. You see that? I will be the one to fight you. As I always tell people, think in yourself. David was small. David never had muscle. And Goliath had everything on him. How can David soon pass through that iron thing to go in Goliath's head? Because when you have on him, only your eyes people can see. And now when in his eyes, David only turned the stone over. And when he just pass it over to go and go use it. Yeah. It takes God to throw stone to pass through iron heaven. No man can do it. Even though Sunday school day said David did like this, but no man can do it. He has a heaven. All because David knew his identity. David knew who he trusted. And he knew his position. Now, for me to close, look at this. In 1 Samuel chapter 11, from verse 1. In verse 1, the Bible says, and Nahash, the king of the Ammonites, came up. He came up. Why did he come to challenge him? Up! Where were they? Up! They were not down. They didn't know their position. How can you be up and somebody from down is challenging you and you're afraid? They didn't know where they were. You need to understand your position. You need to know where you are. Before your help comes, you must know yourself. You see, if you don't know who you are, you won't know who you are expecting. Because David knew his identity. David said, no matter who is against me, I don't care how many witches are working against me. You're not hearing me here. No matter how many wizards and souls are working against me, no matter how many persons are jealous of me, but as for me, because I know my identity, I know who I'm depending on, I know my position, I will lift up my eyes to the hill from whence cometh my help. My help coming. Oh, come on. to expect help from? My help is on the way. Or it's not coming from any soul bush. You can expect help from one witch doctor who got a horse laying on one side and the house is singing, "Don't leave me this way." Your help is on the way, but where is your help coming from? David told Saul, "You guys don't know where to expect help from." That is the reason why Goliath is just shouting over your head every morning and every night. But I know where my help can come from. When I was taking care of my father's sheep, he said the lion and the bear came and it took the sheep. But where my help is coming from for Goliath, my help came from there before. And the Lord gave me the bear and the lion with my bare hands. That's the simplest of expecting my help. I don't know where you expected help. When you know who you are, you know who to expect. I've been to many places around the world, but I've not seen anyone that knows their identity like Americans. What makes them proud is because they know their identity. Imagine they can be in your country. They came to your country. And when they are moving, they are bluffing. Even your own brother, who went as a refugee, when he comes back, he behaves extra than everybody. Yeah. It's just identity change by passport. Not even by nature, but by passport. Because he changed his identity by passport, he gave him a different passport. So his identity is important to everybody in their life. Because you don't know that. He even wants people who is water bottle behind him. Nobody comes from Congo, comes from Australia and other places, and they behave like the way the Americans behave. You know that? We have people coming from everywhere. They don't behave like that. Because the Americans are people who understand identity. They are in some other country, you temple with them, they know that Mary will come for you. Yeah. Because of who they are. So they shout, they make all kind of mouth. Are you hearing me, somebody? Yeah. How much more about you? A child of God. Yeah. Someone that God decided to pay heavy price for. He changed your identity from your mother's child and your father's child to the child of God. How did he do that? He used the blood of Jesus and changed your identity. So whatever is against you now and tempering with you, your help is coming. Because the one that paid the blood of Jesus cannot afford to lose what he paid the highest price for. That's why I'm sure that my help is coming. Because the price that was paid for me is too high for God to allow some stupid thing to take me away. The price he paid for me is too high. Yeah. So I know that help will come. Yeah. You know, the American law in war and rescuing the people is that before one citizen that they went out to rescue would die, 8 Marines must have died. So 8 soldiers to one citizen. Because they feel they are invested in their citizen. And do you know what God has invested in you? For you not to be expecting help. When your wicked uncle is arising, is rising up against you, you know what God has invested in me? No, you are hearing this. Do you know what God has invested? For one stupid person in the corner, calling yourself some kind of need, whether imam or whatever, to say they are challenging me. Listen to me. 20th 17, there was a lot of frustration in this town. Because there are some guys who don't even know who they are dealing with, and they say they are passing in the corner to make covenant, to make agreements. People who don't know their identity, they want to make agreements with Islam to help them get out of there and get all kinds of stores. And think that it's a way to make their way to the top. But just a simple word will frustrate them. Just a simple statement will bring them down. Stop them, confuse them, bring them against themselves. Are you hearing me, somebody? In the name of Jesus, they will see frustration. In the name of Jesus, you will see many politicians, the Lord, that they are mad. Because they are going against their will and the purpose of God for this nation. But there are people here who know their identity. There are people here who know that God paid a price. Go and tell them I said, I'm not afraid. Help us. The Bible said, and Nahash came up. They were up. And they thought they were down. Somebody from town telling you I will deal with you. I see anybody from Ghana. The Accra boys, they got muff. People from Accra, they got muff. That's okay. Imagine when they are fighting, they can be under, you can knock them down, they are under, they say, when I get up, I will finish with you. You are coming, where are you get up? And you allow one devil like Accra boy to make you scared while he's under you. You are up! And the Bible said the man came up to challenge him. And he never knew they were up. And they said to him, come on, let's make a covenant. You see, people compromise when they don't know their identity. People compromise when they don't know how much God has paid for them. People compromise when they don't know their position. People compromise when they don't know who is backing them. When you don't know who is waiting to fight for you, you compromise. For the first time in life's history, every time when you read about God, they will tell you that God is sitting. Heaven is his throne. He's sitting in heaven. You know, when you're talking about God, you say, my God is sitting in heaven. The old men are sitting up there. Every time he's sitting. But when we're about to kill Stephen, the first time for the recorded that God was standing. They were stoning him to die. And God stood. And you know, if God arises, your enemies will scatter. And many of you don't even know that he is standing even in your crisis. Ready to show up. But Stephen loved the beauty of heaven. He said, no, God, don't stop over there. Let them do what they can do. God, I want to be over there. He preferred. It can come to a point of time that even God wants to fight for you. He said, prepare. But your helper is always there. Did your sister tell you a story that happened in Australia a few weeks ago? One lady we prayed for by the name of Emma in Pastor Moses' church. The doctor said she had cancer. 3 years ago, we were there, they expected her to have died. But by God's grace, we prayed. And the Lord kept her when they had given up on her. But at a point of time, you know, when people are in pain, they are miserable, they don't even know where to look for help. But they tell you somebody in Kabbalah, in Frita, they will go there. Somebody in Nigeria, in one village, they will go there. In Guinea, they will go there. And she was going around, coming to Africa and going back with her big foot. But to make the story short, she died a few weeks ago in the hospital. So after she was pronounced dead, 7 hours after, they were taking her to the mortuary. And while they were carrying her, she woke up and asked for water to drink. Ask your sister, she'll tell you a true story. She asked for water to drink. And because of that, more than 200 persons went to the hospital to see. And after she drank, she stayed up until the following day, on Saturday. She died first on Friday. And she got up that same Friday evening. So she was around until Saturday. Then she called the brother and said, you know what? Where I went first, they told me it was not my place and they sent me back. So the pastors went there, Pastor Moses and others went there, and they led her to Christ again. Rededicated her to the Lord. So after all this, she told the brother, said, the new place I see now is better, so I think I won't be here. Now she's living back. I'm telling you a true story. They just buried her a few weeks ago. That was how she slept in that. So sometimes your help can be coming, but some people decide, well, I want to be on that side. Or help came even when she died. Her help came even when she died. Hell refusal. He said, madam, you don't belong here. You are a child of God. You need to visit our medicine then and go. God is happy for you. Amen. 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 Your help is coming. Amen. And the Bible says in verse 6, let us close down for today, we'll continue tomorrow. In verse 6, the Bible says that the people went crying after they told Nash. They said, hey, wait. We want to make agreement. He said, the only condition for me to have covenant with you people is that everybody should remove their right eye. Imagine the name to disgrace the whole nation. And the whole nation will be having one eye. So they said, well, we are not saying no. The condition was looking hopeless. Nobody could challenge the Nash. Nobody could challenge the Ammonites that came against them. It was hopeless. So they said, give us 7 days. Give us 7 days. I want you to know, just tell your enemy, give me 7 days. Come on, give me
7 days.
Give me
7 days.
Because you can torment me now. But on the 7th day, God will give you rest. Amen. You are just charging them to take you to your Sabbath. On the 7th day, God will give me rest. So give us 7 days. Let us go and meet the elders and come back. If anything will come back to you. So they went around, they were crying. Saul came from the field and heard the people crying. He said, what's going on? And they explained the story. They said, the Ammonites have come and they want to take everybody one eye. And the Bible says that when Saul heard it, the anointing came upon him. Even though Saul was the one that initiated everything, but it happened because of the anointing. Your help can only come from God. No matter what you are faced with, don't look for men. It was because of the anointing upon Saul's life that they got solution. That's why the Bible says when they went and gave the news, all the people were glad. Why? Because there was an anointed man. Listen to me, somebody. That is the reason why God orchestrated and organized and planned and programmed this entire time that you are spending here, because he knows that he has anointed a man. He has anointed some men to come here this time to come and roll away your reproach. I've come to let you know everything that is bringing shame to you, bringing disgrace to you, by the end of this program, everything will give way in the name of Jesus Christ. I don't know what the enemy has promised to do to you, they will not submit to him. But I've come to let you know, don't surrender. No retreat, no surrender. Help is on the way. Oh, Rabbi Shaka Yakaba. I said, no retreat. I'm not going back. I'm not going to give up. Because my help is on the way.
on the way. That is why God has sent anointed men. He took anointed Saul to rule away the reproach. He took anointed Saul to take away the disgrace. By the anointing of God upon this ministry, by the anointing of God upon the lives of the men of God that he sent, and by the commission and the anointing that he has given to me, I declare to you, your help has come. And that thing that they are holding you will let you go in the name of Jesus Christ. I said, I will let you go in the name of Jesus Christ. What is the name of that thing that will stop you from making it? What is it that will make you to cry all the days of your life? Oh, they were crying, hopeless cry, but then Saul showed up with the anointing. I have come with the anointing of God. Whatever makes your night sleepless, I destroy that thing from your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Anything that brought shame and disgrace to you, I remove it from your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Listen to me, anything that makes you want to look down on you and make you to think that you are going nowhere in life, anything that makes you want to treat you anyhow, I break that power from your life. I break it 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 from your life. In the name of Jesus Christ. I release you from that curse today. That curse that they place on you, I release you from that curse today. By the same anointing that Moses used to set women free, I don't care whether it's your own mother, your own father, your grandmother, your grandfather, and the chief of your village, I tell you tonight, I break that curse on your life. After this meeting, you are moving into another season. I say you are moving to another season. You are getting out of the season of disappointment. You are moving into the season of favor. You are getting out of the season of disgrace. You are going to the season that will celebrate you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I come by the anointing of God, and I usher you into a new season. I usher you into a different season. The season that people will celebrate you. The season that people will honor you. The season that will come to you among the blessed people. I usher you into that season in the name of Jesus. It's a new season for you. I said it's a new season for you. It is a new season for you. What God has given every anointed man is a mouth. A mouth with his words in it. And that is why he will use to change your season. When God wanted to change the atmosphere and create everything, he used his mouth and his word. When God wanted to save people, he used their mouths and his word. And so I declare to you today, I don't know who has been holding you, but that hand will go paralyzed. That hand will have no strength to hold you anymore. I said that hand will have no strength to hold you anymore. As Egypt cannot continue Israel, they cannot continue anymore. I see you getting out of their reach in the name of Jesus. I see you walking away from people that held you down. I see you walking away from people that held you down. I see you walking away from people that are holding you captive. I see the prison gates are open, and I see people walking out free in the name of Jesus Christ. Everyone here under the sound of my voice, you will step into your destiny. I said you will step into your destiny. You will step into your destiny. You will step into your destiny. There shall be no power strong enough to stop you. He said, by him we ran through troops. By him we went over walls. I see you running through troops and you're not falling in ambush. Father, I thank you for the people tonight. Lord, by
your special grace. Anything that is causing anyone pain, whether it's broken relationship, whether it's disappointment that they got recently, whether it's any kind of sickness or bad news that it brought to them, like the children of Jabesh Gilead, Father, by your special grace and your anointing, I speak healing right now. I speak healing right now. You are their helper. Father, we thank you and we give you praise. In Jesus' name. Come on, celebrate the Lord. Somebody. Celebrate the Lord.